thank you very much, sir. Respected Professor Pradeep Mehta, Netaraji, other members of the family of Mahesh Buch and friends. I am grateful for the kind sentiments expressed in the introductions, and I must first respond that I'm not confident that I know much about many things, and certainly not on black money as such, but that's why I said understanding black money. In fact, some time back, recently, in a conversation, the finance minister, Mr. Arun Jaitley, asked me at that time whether the interest rate policy that the governor was adopting, you know, the inclination was it should be lower. So he said, what do you think? Do you think the interest rate now that RBI is doing is right? I said, I don't know. How do you say you don't know? Sir, even when I was governor, I was not sure whether the interest rate policy, what was the correct interest rate policy? Because it's all a matter of judgment. You are looking at the future, making assumptions, making judgments. So even in a matter like interest rate, where things should be clear and we are dealing with institutions, if I was not certain whether what I was doing is right or what I was doing, thinking was right, I can assure you that I am less confident in talking about black money by definition, because it is black. So I want to assure you that it's going to be a little more of sharing my lack of understanding than understanding of the black money. So I want to caution that. More formally, I'm greatly honored by the invitation from the National Center for Human Settlements and Environment to deliver the second Mahesh Buch Memorial Lecture. I knew him well at a personal level, though I did not work with him directly. He had a formidable reputation for intellect, courage of conviction, impeccable honesty, and devotion to public service. He commanded admiration, affection, loyalty, respect from many people, and envy from a few people, and a little irritation from a fewer people, but that's natural. And he was prophetic. He was prophetic in anticipating the importance of environmental issues. And of course, smart cities or things that are being talked now, 30 years afterwards. So he was prophetic. And he was very special to Bhopal. He made Bhopal what it is, a modern city. And Bhopal has also been very special to him, from whatever I hear. Buch Sahab has been a role model for many people in the Indian Administrative Service. He has been particularly kind to me, and in fact was very appreciative of my work in the Reserve Bank of India. And therefore, I am, for more than one reason, beholden to Nirmalaji for giving me the opportunity to come here and pay my tributes to a great son of India and the pride of the IAS. Mahesh Buch was actually sensitive to contemporary issues, and at the same time, he used to go into very minute detail, but at the same time never missed the big picture, or the vision. So, considering his interest on the big picture as well as the detail, I thought that understanding black money is both of contextual relevance and systemic importance. I can assure you this subject was selected almost 1 year ago. It was actually meant to be for the last year, and I couldn't make it. So it has nothing to do with the contemporary issues, I want to assure you, though I will make a brief mention. Actually, my interest in black money goes back to 1960. After I passed my degree, I wanted to register for PhD. I went to my guide and I said, I want to do research on black money. He said, what do you mean? There's no data. When there's no data, you can't do research, you can't do PhD. And therefore, I was given the subject concentration of economic power, and that also later in monopoly, I changed the subject. So that's how I began my interest in black money. But at a policy level, the first time I came into contact with the issue of black money was in 1991. At the time of the crisis in 1991, I was handling the balance of payments division in the Ministry of Finance, you know, all the selling gold, sending gold, etc. So I was the joint secretary who had to deal with all those things for 3 years. At that time, one of the things we had to do as you know, one of the reasons for the crisis was a lot of NRI threw the money. And then when we are getting on to the reform, there is a proposal that we should get some money from the NRIs by getting contribution to the bonds. So those bonds, the issue was whether amnesty should be given, sort of, you know, we should send the money, then we won't question where it went, if the NRI sent, repatriated the money. So it was sort of a special amnesty scheme. And when it was introduced, there was a lot of debate. But IMF never believed such money will come. But major difference was at that time, we had a very, very high level of taxes, an unrealistic exchange rate, and therefore we said we're going to have big reform. When there's a big reform, it's a once, just do it once. It's an extraordinary circumstance for the country and extraordinary shift in the policy. And therefore, I also felt that it is appropriate to go through this regime shift. So there's a paradigm shift in the policy, there's a regime shift in the whole economic management, and therefore giving this this special dispensation was good. And in those days, we thought that it is just one-time measure. We were mistaken. In 1997, there was a voluntary disclosure scheme which did not have any relationship with the foreign exchange problem. It did not have any relationship with any particular issue. But again, I think the whole idea was that there will be changes in policy, somewhat changes in policy, and therefore it will be a good idea to start on a cleaner slate. I was at that time deputy governor, and in the discussions that I participated, I felt that it will be inappropriate to do something like that on the basis of our theory and our own experience. But anyway, the decision was taken. Then I'm not aware whether there has been any evaluation, either by a parliamentary committee or by a research institution, as to whether it served the purpose. We don't have it. There are not many countries where something like that would not have been a study of research or a study of a parliamentary committee. It is not there. Now, let me go back to another issue. This is related. In 1996 December, at the time of the whole issue of exchange market development, I had given a talk where I said that you should permit gold to be imported through official channels with a very small duty. So for 40-50 years, the whole idea was gold is bad, it's a waste of money, and also it's an important means of black money. So in a way, what has happened is that because you ban the gold, any transaction in gold became black. And then at that stage, I gave a lecture in the context of the capital account liberalization and in the context of the foreign exchange markets. After oil, maximum foreign exchange is in reality spent on import of gold. There is no domestic production of gold. There is demand. So if you have, whether you like it or not, either it is official or unofficial, you are going to import gold. And you are going to spend money in foreign exchange. The whole issue is whether it will be official or unofficial. So then I said that how do you handle a foreign exchange market when, after oil, the second largest commodity is coming unofficial channels? Can I stop it? It's not possible. And therefore my proposal was accepted, number one. Second, I also questioned the hypothesis that it is a waste. First of all, we cannot sit in judgment whether import of aftershave lotion for gentlemen is more productive than a small jewel for a lady. So it's a general discrimination. Second, my argument was, and I articulated this, that my argument was that for women, property rights are very inadequate, non-enforceable in India, particularly for poorer and lower middle class people. Finally, it is one of the very few things that poor women keep it away from the drunken husbands. And the population is growing. And therefore, I said that it has to be liberalized, both in terms of foreign exchange market management, economic management, and appropriateness to the socio-cultural conditions. And fortunately, the Capital Account Convertibility Committee took formal notice and then recommended, and it has been done. And since then, here and occasionally, the duty is increased, but they have to reduce it. Because you cannot manage by imagining something which is not real. But the whole issue is the link between gold. People have a psychological link between gold and black money. Because for 40, 50 years, after 1950, for 50 years, all gold was illegal. So mentally you think that anything to gold, where is the question for most of the demands, is both a consumption and investment good. It is not just black money investment. So if you make an estimate of the amount of black money that goes into the gold, or gold as a transaction for the black money, then it is a small percentage of the totality. And therefore the equation is more psychological than real. And so that delinking was something that I felt that should be recognized in the policy, and it has been recognized. Though on and off again we get so experience with the liberalization of gold shows. What does the experience show? It did not result in foreign exchange crisis. It did not result in current account deficit going. It did not. You see, the interesting part was after we liberalized, you didn't get into serious problems. In fact, so in a way, what I would say is that by and large, in retrospect, perhaps that was not liberalization of gold was not an unwise decision on the basis of as it evolved. Now we come to 1998. In 1998, the USA imposed sanctions. In fact, it is very few people realize that when a country like the USA imposed the sanctions, the impact should have been quite large. It almost went unnoticed. Usually the impact is on the external sector. And the credit goes to Dr. Jarrah and Mahesh Buch Memori. The whole thing was so nicely managed because we estimated the possible impact of the BOP. We felt that we should take special measures and we had to get the foreign exchange to fill up the measures. Once we are able to take care of that, and then we involved American banks located outside America to get that. So, but there was a strategy. There was an estimate of the possible impact of the sanctions, what we should do, and that was done. At that point of time, precedent came. 1991 amnesty. Give amnesty now. There was a debate. And I took a firm stand, no. Now we should not do it. That was a regime shift. This is just a difficulty that the country is facing. And therefore, if we pay a higher price, let us pay a higher interest and get the money. But let us not reopen the issue of amnesty, etc., etc. Unfortunately, the finance minister and the governor agreed, and we succeeded. Not only we succeeded, in order to add to the reserve, there was another one also, without any amnesty. So this is how we had proved that it is possible to do things if you want, not necessarily with amnesty, if that is the only purpose. Then in September 2003, I took over as governor. I just thought that I give a first-hand account of my brush with the black money, which in a way influences my understanding of the whole concept of black money. In September, as soon as I took over, one of the first things that I did, we did in that way, not I, and in fact it was processed before, only the last my decision, is on the participatory notes. There is, as you know, there is a lot of money, black money, naturally most of it, it goes and comes through the round tripping. Is the round tripping, it is the issue. In the context of the round tripping, on the basis of the parliamentary committee inquiry into the Ketan Parekh scam, they suspected two important routes. One is called overseas corporate bodies, where the overseas NRI companies, overseas, can get money and invest in our markets. Second is the participatory notes, which are sold, they are derivative instruments. So you do not know who is in the both cases, you do not know who is the beneficial owner. So there are wheel after wheel, you do not know the beneficial owner. And therefore there was a doubt whether this could be an important means by which money is going out, is coming out. So, in 2-3 weeks after I joined, I concluded that this is an important group. And so, one evening, 6:15, we issued a notification saying that henceforth, no money can come through overseas corporate bodies. Those who are already here, they can sell and take the money back whenever they want to. No fresh inflows. Fortunately, we had Mr. Jaswant Singh as the finance minister. He called early morning next day and he said, "What's happening?" So I said, "Sir, don't worry. Nothing will happen." He said, "No, no, but they said the stock markets will fall." I said, "Yes, sir, they'll fall." "So, sure, they will fall because unhealthy flows will go away. After that, we'll get a lot of healthy flows. We'll get more healthy flows after we put a stop to unhealthy flows." So he said, "What should I tell them?" I said, "You tell them exactly what I told you, sir. You tell them. You can say that this is what I mentioned and we are confident." That was the end of the OCPs. As far as the participatory notes are concerned, I had discussed with the chairman SEBI at that point of time, and it was agreed that there is a ban in the participatory notes also. It was supposed to be approved by the SEBI board. It was not. And there it is, it's pending. It has been pending. Then 2005, there was a committee appointed by the Ministry of Finance to liberalize the foreign institutional investors regime, FII flow regime, but with appropriate safeguards with regard to the beneficial ownership. That committee gave a report suggesting that some safeguards should be there for the participating notes, and you must try to identify the beneficial ownership. In that committee, an RBI officer was a member, and that RBI member has written a note of dissent and said that nothing less than banning of the participatory notes will be acceptable to RBI. It is still there, those of you who want to read, what was the reason, and so on they talk. Anyway, it is there, and there are safeguards, and the whole approach is now, continues to be, that participatory notes will be permitted with adequate safeguards of, but our point of view was, to the extent it is outside, there is no way after somebody telling you that it is, I am the owner, there is no way. So we were, but what was the reason, but that is the official policy. Now, so after that, from 2008, from the time I retired, I have been engaging in academic activities. So in that capacity, all I have been doing is only watching and occasionally reading the newspapers on the subject. So from now on, that's what I'll be sharing with you, what I read in the papers, but therefore I'll be very brief. Well, more recently, I think the very comprehensive document about the official understanding of the white paper, of black money, is in the white paper placed by the Ministry of Finance in 2012. I think that's a very comprehensive, not necessarily that I entirely agree, but that's a very comprehensive account. The paper defines black money as assets and resources that have neither been reported to the public authorities at the time of their generation, nor disclosed at any point of time during their possession. The paper explains the black money can be generated either through illegal activities. Of course, naturally, once it is through illegal activities, it continues to be black in some way or another. And the paper wisely does not provide any definitive estimate of the amount of black money currently generated in India. Due to lack of unanimity or consensus, according to, about the best approach to be used. Certain sectors are highlighted as being more vulnerable to black money issues. These include, according to the report, real estate, bullion and jewelry, financial markets, public procurement, interestingly the non-profit sector, that's interesting, informal sector, that's interesting, and cash sector, broadly. The paper highlights the issue of Indian assets held abroad, particularly in Swiss banks. The white paper is an excellent account of the problems and the approaches to remedy the situation. Mainly, it is, if you read it, it is mainly from the point of view of tax administration. And the paper gives an impression that the main focus is on income tax. and foreign exchange regulations. The whole approach is income tax violations and FERA-FERMA violations. And I think this is the two pillars, and that is how the approach is. Understandably, the issues of election funding has not been highlighted. Understandably, you will understand. Even if you don't understand black money, you will understand this. Then there are more recent sources of generation of black money, like education and health. Private education and private health have become an important sources. And of course, there is sometimes a reference to this what I may call the rural farmer cum politicians. Farming cannot produce black money by definition, because it's exempt from income tax. If you are taking interest, by definition it cannot. Secondly, it accounts for barely 15% of GDP. Agriculture farming accounts for 15% of GDP. But the strength comes, that's not where the black money is generated. It is generated because this sector, which accounts for 15% of the GDP, employs 60% of the labor force. 60% of the votes are in agriculture. And those who control the rural farming community are in a position to control so much votes. So they have many political and other activities which gives a strength. So in a way, what I would say is it's rural political, but not farming, that produces the black money. And that is how to fall. That's why I deliberately said it's not covering election funding. So this is where I will leave the subject. But then in January 2011, Supreme Court, in response to a writ petition, asked government why the names of those who have, and this is an important development, who have stashed the money in the particular bank have not been disclosed. I think that was the question raised. The court felt that the government should be more forthcoming in releasing an all available information on what it called a mind-boggling amount of money held illegally in foreign banks. The Supreme Court on 4th July ordered the appointment of a special investigating team headed by a former Supreme Court judge. And then it was said that this body would report to the Supreme Court directly, and no other agency will be involved in this. And it has been making a series of recommendations. Recommendations are going on 1, 2, 3, 4. I think June they had 5. 3 page, 1 page, 2 page, 5 page, etc. So the 5th one in the series of recommendations was issued in July. And among other things, there's a reference to the notification. There in the notification of prospective notes, there's a reference in that also. And also about money laundering. It notes the efforts made by SEBI. My view has been that the design of the intent of the instrument of the design of the intent of the design of the instrument itself is to conceal the beneficial ownership. And regulator has to depend entirely on non-verifiable details. The dissent note of RBI, which I mentioned, has highlighted this. But it is, but I think as of now, it is the official policy is to accept that it is possible to monitor. Now we come to the central government, more recently May 2016, disclosed the various decisions taken by the government in the recent past and to curb, quote unquote, the menace of black money, both within and outside the country, the last 2 years. These include enactment of a new Black Money Act, with strict penalty provisions, allowing people to declare undisclosed income or assets has been allowed after paying 45%. Incidentally, it has yielded some big number, right? 60,000 crores or something? 65,000 crores. 65,000 crores is 0.45% of the GDP. And in 1997, the amount collected was 0.60% of GDP. And incidentally, 0.45% of GDP is about the same amount given by Reserve Bank of India to Government of India last year and this year as its dividends. So those are the magnitudes that we are talking about. Then of course there is a reference to Amendment to Foreign Exchange Management Act 1999 providing for the seizure and confiscation of value equivalents situated in India in case any person is found to have acquired any foreign exchange, foreign security or removable property situated outside India. We are going to find out the black money real estate outside India. So just I want you to understand that that's what we are trying to do now, having found out everything in India. Now let me come to the approach. In reality basically is one of strengthening the punishment approach. As we see it, it's basically a question of strengthening the law. And if any violates, you expand what you define as violation and then increase the punishments. I think that is basically the strategy of that, and whether it is in India or abroad, and more so if it is abroad. I think that's more or less the policy. Now what is my understanding, as I said, I'm not sure, but let me be analytical. First, black money is often described as parallel economy, correct? But it's not exactly parallel. Black and white changes within a day. Not conversion. Just let's see. When buildings are constructed, we know that it is partly funded by black money. But when the wages are paid to the worker, that is not black money for him. He works for the day. For him, it is white money. He goes to the shop and purchases the daily grain and a vegetable for cooking his meal. When he pays and when the shopkeeper sells him, it is not black money. It is white money. But in the night at 11 o'clock, the mafia comes and collects money from the shopkeeper. Then that is black. So it is not parallel. White becomes black, black becomes white during the course of the day. So that first characteristic I thought we should understand. Second, experience with tax amnesty to convert black money into white has not helped in curbing generation of black money. And the amount of black money mobilized through amnesty is very small. I'm not even going into the issue of, you know, the other issue that whenever you get an amnesty, the regular collection falls a bit. So the net collection you have to calculate. This is nothing new, but this has been the analysis. And this is international. I'm nothing unique, nothing Indian about it. But in fact, many people ask me that if yesterday's black money can become tomorrow's white money, what is wrong with it? How can it be morally wrong if yesterday's black money can become white money by a government order or something like that? So the whole question of morality and ethics will be very difficult to introduce that concept at that once you take recourse to this. So my limited point is that once you give amnesty, you are right to question ethical, and especially if you do it often, it becomes a problem. Third, black money is both a stock and a flow. Very often we think it's a stock and you pick it up. No, it's a stock. The stock comes because there is a net addition to flow. You take it out, you bring it in. You take it out, you bring it in. Sometimes you increase the stock sometimes. Suppose some bank puts pressure and you have to repay the bank loan. Then you require white money. Then you will convert the stock into flow and give it to that. Particularly during amnesty that is required. Because if you have money, you have to pay to the bank. You require white money, no? So then you convert from the stock of black money into flow of white money. And then you want to act. So the question is, it is not a stock. It's both a stock and a flow. The quantity of the stock increases or decreases, depending on the flow in or flow out. So, therefore, in a way, therefore, and as I mentioned, the flow is always a combination. Then we go into the next part. The question is, a part of the black money is domestically generated black money may be moved out and stashed abroad or used abroad. Agree? But stashed in the banks. You see, black money which is in the form of foreign assets may not be held purely in bank deposits. If a person is so intelligent, clever, to take the trouble of taking the money and putting it in Swiss accounts, why should it be wasted lying there? It has to be used, no? And therefore, it will always be. In a way, therefore, the foreign asset that I'll bring back the stock of money, the stock is not there, it has gone there and it has gone somewhere else, most probably to Bombay again back there. That's what wrong to them. So we don't know how much of this and how much of that. So to the idea that there is a net addition to the capital available in India is not necessarily right, because the stock is not there. It is a comeback as a stock here, if the suspicions are right. So I think we have to be clear about mind how much of the stock that has gone out is in the form of a flow that has gone out, is remaining as a stock there, or has been converted into a flow into India, or converted into a flow into somewhere else. We don't have the estimate. Fifth, the extent to which the black money is held in the form of foreign assets by Indian residents depends also on the policies of other countries. When the other countries tighten, then money will find, not much, too much money will go. Sometimes even the gold, demand for gold may go up. So I think we have to recognize that this is a question of arbitrage in some senses. Sixth, it is useful, how much time do I have? 10 minutes, I'll take another 10 minutes. Sixth, it is useful to make a distinction between black money generated by cross-border criminal activities, which is different from other transactions. Because criminal money, it will not come into white easily. Whereas other non-declaration, if it's possible, so there is a distinction, they'll remain more or less what I call underground money. Seventh, gold economy in India has been associated with smuggling, and I explained that. So the equating gold with the black money, magnitudinally is not right, psychologically it may be there. Eighth, there is some feeling that black money slashed abroad sometimes is viewed in popular perception as more dangerous, very bad. So I'm reminded, apparently, when long years back, somebody said, I am sure it is a joke, when Pandit Nehru was asked about the corruption of Chief Minister, he supposed to have said, oh, anyway, the money is in India. So if that is the attitude, but I'm sure that will not be acceptable now. But the whole issue is that money held abroad is different from money held here. Valuable foreign exchange, I'm not sure, in the current environment, is valuable foreign exchange business is important. So now let me leave you there. Let me quickly run through what is the review of experience. Firstly, when we started with the reform process, those of us who worked on the reforms, we felt that once you have a reasonably good tax policy, and once you have a realistic foreign exchange rate, once you have a reasonable exchange rate, and once you have a reasonable tax rate, there should be no temptation to take it out. Normal, rational human beings should not take it out when the exchange rate is market determined and when the taxes are comparable. But what has happened? The tax rate, income tax rate in India is one of the lowest in the major economies of the world. There is no inheritance tax. There is virtually no gift tax. It is impossible to find a country of similar size, except perhaps small North European countries where the social security is very high. So high taxes being responsible for quote-unquote black money is not confirmed by the experience. Second, second is the transfer of money outside the country is a subset of the bigger problem of black money. It's not independent problem, it's a part of the bigger problem. And there is an overseas market for foreign exchange. Earlier it used to be black. Now it's no longer black because you can't control it in any case. So this is called offshore market. And actually the offshore market rate of the foreign exchange is not much different from the onshore market. So there again, you don't have the explanation now. Earlier there used to be a premium, but it's not there. So that doesn't also explain. These factors, economic factors, don't explain why it is happening. And earlier, maybe, you know, when you went abroad for medical treatment, something, you have to ask your brother-in-law to somehow get some money for an exchange. After Kushner, you go to the bank, and you get the money. For a student, you want money is liberally available for your day-to-day transactions. So there's no need to produce that money for that type of business also. And then why? Why is it still happening? We had in the past years, long back, punishments, severe punishments, that, this. They didn't work. And then you liberalize. We don't know. It's not as though the liberalization has resulted in any economic inefficiencies. It does not. So what's happening? So it is it's difficult to assert that deregulation has done some damage. Then fourthly, there is a view that fairness promotes compliances with tax laws. If a rich person buys and sells shares, hundreds of crores, it's virtually non-taxable because you are reinvesting. Whether if you go and work hard and get your 25,000 or 50,000, 60,000, you sell 30%. So if it is possible to avoid, you will always feel justified that. So the fairness in the tax regime, the fairness in the tax implementation, the fairness in the generality of the system. So that's one possible explanation, which I think was advanced by Professor Mahesh Buch from Calcutta at some stage, but it will not be pursued further. Second, in the reform period, there has been reforms, but it resulted in what may be called business-friendly regimes rather than market-friendly regimes. So market-friendly regimes is equitable, rule of law, opportunity available, that's markets. Whereas business-friendly is that you are favorable to some businesses who are in business already type of thing. So one explanation that's advocated is that the reform has been essentially business-friendly rather than market-friendly. So in other words, we get into the issue of rule-based. I generally say that there generally all over the world is contract-based economic relationships. In India, it is contact-based relationships. And usually in other countries, it is, people are judged on relative merits. And here is a relative's merit. That is the type of issues that come up. So that means when we don't understand by the normal logic, then there is something different. And that's what we may have to look for. How do we look for? What I try to do is, I said, perhaps we should ask new questions. Different questions. If you ask the same question, you are getting the same answer. Which is slightly different from, as you know, Professor Keynes. I don't know whether you know this. Once a professor was asked to set a question paper. And when they found out, it was exactly the same question paper as the last year. He was too lazy, perhaps, to change the question paper. So the dean called him and asked, I said, what is this? You have given the same question paper. He said, yes. Why? But what? He said, yes. The knowledge has advanced in 1 year. Therefore, the answers will have to be different now. I want to judge whether the students are following the developments in the knowledge. But I am not in that league. So I will put it what I would call different questions. I am not saying right questions. They may be right. They may not be right. But suppose we ask different questions. And then maybe some different answers will come. And let me start one. Benami Transactions Prohibition Act was enacted in 1988. I think President gave the assent, it was enacted. Regulation had to be framed, 1988. 25 years, no regulation. President was not bothered after having signed. Law has been passed by the Parliament, no implementation. The executive didn't implement it. The judiciary did not question it. a law duly approved by Parliament. Normal courts, we expect a law to be implemented by the AG, to be dictated by the judiciary. Nothing of that process has happened for 25 years. And in 2015, the President unconcerned about implementation, the Parliament indifferent as to what they have done has been implemented, the executive had no compulsion to explain. So, what's happening? I don't know. Okay. But everybody now agrees that Benami is an important component of the whole issue of black money. If that is the most important component of the black money, then we are still thinking about it, because it's very important, I suppose. We are proceeding on the assumption that government agencies, in the whole approach, should be empowered to punish the citizens who generate black money. I think that is the whole logic is, you must empower the government agencies to punish the citizens. At the same time, the Supreme Court wants to make sure that such powers are not misused. So the Supreme Court says, I will have a special investigation team. I don't trust that they will disclose the names. And they will not be responsible. What's happening? This is supervisory functions of investigation and administration to be taken over by judiciary, which certainly is not its expertise. What's happening? I don't know. So, but then the question is it possible that generation, circulation and multiplication of black money are symptoms of lawlessness in the system? All-pervading lawlessness. Is lawlessness defined as lack of respect for contracts? Explicit or implicit? Prevalent both in dealings by the government and the citizens. The question asked is whether the government and governmental agencies are honoring the contracts, implicit or explicit. The contract is that if you file an FIR, FIR has to register, get the contract. Are you sure you can do that? You can go step after step. So then you ask the question, then I leave it there. There are many interactions between the government and the citizens, and between citizens. Payment of taxes is one of them. If the government does not perform its duties honestly, as I mentioned, like accepting first information report, or for instance, if you give your building for rent to a public sector bank, after the contract, are you sure it will be vacated by the public sector bank or by the government itself? So you have these questions. These questions have to be there. In other words, is black money a manifestation of broader problem of lack of mechanism for enforcement of contracts between private parties and government, and between private parties and government, and in fact even between government agencies. Within government agencies also. Question mark. More generally, is it possible that generation, it's not only contract, but is it possible generation, perpetuation and multiplication is merely a reflection of inappropriate laws and undermining of such laws by public institutions themselves because they are simply inappropriate? How far are the three wings of governance, legislative, executive and judiciary, responsible for this large presence of black money? Not one or the other. I think that's a question that, how much should we assign the responsibilities is a question perhaps. Once you ask these questions, then you get a suspicion that possibly black money is merely a symptom of a deeper disease, very complex disease, and we don't understand. So what I found in my experience is that when there's a complex issue, you don't understand, look around and study some theory. Theory does not give solutions, but theory helps you to understand. So now, of course, a retired man sitting in Hyderabad, so all I could do is I picked up a few books which at some stage in life were gifted to me. So I said, let me see, even outdated. So I found three books. which were relevant. One is Law and Economics by Robert Cooter and Thomas Olin, which was gifted to me in 2001. Huh? 15 years it has taken for me to pull it out of my small library. The second one, titled Lawlessness and Economics, by Professor Avinash Dixit, who should have got Nobel Prize, he may still get. That was gifted to me in 2007, only 9 years. Then there is another one which was gifted to me only last year. That is by Professor Kaushik Basu, an economist in the real world, The Art of Policy Making in India. So, I mean, that's, these are the three books. This is the latest. And before I move on, I read out two important paragraphs from Kaushik Basu, who has seen for a couple of years, he has been academic, but he was in the government for 2 years, and he is now senior vice president of the World Bank. And I quote these two paragraphs. Quote, a poorly implemented law, or for that matter, a well-implemented one, can do devastating damage to an economy. It's not necessary that only a poorly implemented law. If it is a bad law, if it is implemented, it can be equally devastating. In the minds of most people, the law is about crime, retribution, justice, and fairness. The fact that the law can be critical in determining the rate of growth of the GDP, the length of the queue for some buying some essential commodity, the level of unemployment, the amount of transaction cost and the trouble that you have to take is something that is widely appreciated. This is especially in developing countries. Another quote. But the fact remains that many a developed, he's talking about developing nations, which keeping India experience view, but the fact remains that many a developing nation has brought great harm upon its economy and development prospects by not enacting a law or by failing to. This is one area where there is a lot yet to be understood and much to be gained from such analysis. Now, Professor Basu goes on to discuss, and he makes an interesting proposition. I don't know whether some of you must have come across. His proposition is that when somebody, you know, when a bribe is given, there are two parties, a bribe giver, bribe taker, and you have to punish both under the law. Now, his proposition was that if a citizen is entitled to a service, and if that service is not given to him, if he gives money, only the bribe taker should be punished, not bribe giver, because bribe giver has no option. He has to give even what he is entitled to get. So the government has a responsibility to punish its own employees rather than to punish the person who was forced to do it. Whereas those who try to distort or get undue advantage from the government, they should be, only such bribe givers should be brought under punishment. So that was his theory, which was severely criticized, though I am far more sympathetic to Professor Basu. But since our subject is not corruption, because again, corruption is one element, as you would notice. Therefore, I would not confuse corruption entirely with the black money. And so, therefore, I would not go into the corruption component of the whole issue. So let me concentrate on what the other two professors have said on institutional economics. Now, let me see. There are two ways of looking at this black money issue. One is it can be viewed as one of crime and punishment. Crime is defined and punishment. The second is as part of broader governance. And we have to look at it in both ways. If people perceive a threat, now let me come to behavioral economics. We go to behavioral economics. If people perceive a threat to their property rights, whether from the government or from any other source, one of their responses will be to conceal their assets to the extent possible. They will hide tangible property. They will deny the existence of intangible property. For example, this is more or less extracted. For example, highly productive individuals, a doctor practitioner gets 10 lakhs, he declares 1 lakh rupees. To have low productivity because they know that if this truth is revealed, the government will simply force them to work more to get the same amount. But the cost of achieving, now the question is, how do you get the perfect revelation? Question is, to get perfect revelation, the cost of achieving perfect revelation by direct supervision or observation is likely to be prohibited. Unless you have one inspector stationed at every doctor to find out how which patient has got the money. So in other words, there is a cost of revelation. And how do you get the revelation? By direct supervision or direct auditing? So that there is a cost. Ultimately, the society is putting, investing money in doing that also. Conventional, most economic activities, interactions. The government will find it desirable. What will the government do? Instead of direct auditing or monitoring practices, they will have material incentives. But the material incentives should be on a continuing basis, not in a once in a while. So the incentive structure should be such that revelation, there should be greater incentive to reveal with minimum cost to the government. And that is the type of way you have to define. Then you get the, you can give material incentives, but then going to broader issue, markets will not succeed. We had a market regime, markets will not succeed unless they are supported by adequate governance institutions. Even the highest capitalist people, they will say that we require rules, we require contracts, so markets. Then, but most economic activities and interactions share several properties that together they create a demand for institutional structure. If you have that type of institutional structure, that is good for economic activity. That institutional structure is a public good. Markets cannot function unless there is a law, the institutional structure. And that institutional structure has to be produced by the government itself. The markets will fail to be optimal if this institutional structure is suboptimal. But conventional economic theory recognizes the importance of law for governance, from Adam Smith days. But till about 30, 40 years ago, the conventional economic theory took the existence of well-functioning law and legal system for granted. So it was assumed that when the market functions, all economic analysis is based on the assumption that when a law is passed by the government, and that will be a good law, and that will be a good public good, it will be provided, and that will be provided at no cost. It's costless. That is how the economic theory was based. And it also assumes that state has a monopoly over the use of coercion. It also assumes that the state designs and enforces laws. The conventional economic theory, till 30, 40 years ago, conventional economic theory assumed that the state designs and enforces law with the objective of maximizing social welfare. Is that true? Economists didn't realize that it is not true for a long time. Because it's very difficult to handle if you accept such truths. So simple model becomes very complicated. Okay. So the usual implicit assumption is that the law operates costlessly. No leakages. Once you accept the law, then the economists start analyzing everything else. But about 40 years ago, economists started thinking differently. They realized that these assumptions are not valid because there are transaction costs, there are motives, there are principal agency problems. So in the economist's ideal picture, the government supplies legal institutions that are guided and solely entirely concerned for social welfare. In reality, the apparatus of law also has cost. It's costly. And apparatus of law can be weak, it can be slow, it can be costly. And all that has to be input if you are analyzing the institutional infrastructures in terms of cost. There's a social cost, cost of producing public goods, there's a private cost, and they have to be viewed together. What happens if the transaction costs are high and legal system too slow or weak? Is that a question relevant for us? I suppose it is. Economic activity does not come to a grinding halt. Economics goes on. So what happens if the transaction costs are high, legal recourse is slow? So what do? Economic activity bypasses. Now I'll give a little story. When I became a deputy governor, I went and had a meeting of 15 or 20 officers in the RBI, senior officers, and I asked them, when you were children, how many of you went to government schools? 90%. Then I said, when you were children, how many of you went to government hospitals? 90%. I said, how many of your children are going to government schools? Not one. Then I said, how many of your children are going to government hospitals? Not one. I said, what has happened? Governments have been bypassed. For RBI, the same thing will happen. When a public good is not produced, the system will find its way of getting it. So you become. So here, then we call it bluff, because it's not declared. So that's one way of looking at it, that once you recognize that it is not possible to have smooth business and the transaction costs exceed, and it becomes a hindrance to economic activity, this is a bypass. In some ways, black money is like the bypass that we are trying to do, like private guards. In olden days, the idea of having private guards in different houses and apartment complex was not there. It's a lot more prevalent now. So it is really a long order function, right? Okay. Now, it basically is, again, we go back to the whole issue of rule-based or relation-based. And it's not as though every country has 100% rule-based or 100% relation-based. It's a mix. And over a period, the rule-based has to keep increasing. Now, what happens is that the process of creating the institutions and the apparatus is expensive. It is expensive. People should be willing to invest in creating public institutions, in public goods. And while these institutions, whether it is judiciary or police, when they demand resources, those resources are not unlimited. So with limited resources, they should also efficiently produce public goods. So don't define the crime in a way that you will have to imprison so many people and you will never be able to imprison anybody, and therefore nobody will. So ultimately there is a cost, so a social cost. So you have to take what is known as optimal crime, optimal definition of a crime, optimal definition of a punishment, keeping in view the social. There is an ethical point, I agree, but ethical point also should recognize that there is a question of cost. There's a cost and incremental benefit. So the benefit of, but the problem is that movement from the old system, there are some beneficiaries of the old system, the new system. And the existing benefits of the old system are not going to easily move towards the new system. So, and that's where there's a public opinion and debate. So we have to accept, we have to recognize how to do this. So I will not go into the whole issue, but what I'm simply saying is that there is an economic theory of also what has predictive model of criminal behavior. A criminal behavior depends on the criminal. A criminal is very rational fellow, perhaps more rational than many of us. So a criminal fellow, intelligent fellow, he will calculate what's the cost and benefits. If I break this law, what's the probability that I'll be caught? What's the probability that there'll be a prosecution? What's the probability that I'll be punished? One of my sons said once, said, I said, look, why are you taking this risk? And I said, well, no, what is the risk? In India, we have democracy, rule of law, decision, appeal, revision. Three levels, at least one I can buy. That's the confidence with which this chap says. Now that will impact in what you are doing. So my limited point is, we all of us, when dealing with black money, perhaps should study the economic theory of crime and predictive model of criminal behavior. Second, there is the economic theory of optimal punishment, and it suggests that the goal should be, then there is a particular goal, and I don't want to go into it, but that's the second thing which theory suggests. So let me conclude by saying that black money is not merely an issue of taxation or non-declaration or committing crime or imposing punishment. It is perhaps a manifestation of a bigger problem of governance. In countries that are moving from relation-based systems to rule-based systems, there are challenges. In dealing with this issue, we cannot take a simplistic view of a benevolent state versus a malevolent citizen. That these extreme positions are a malevolent market participant. There is nothing like a benevolent state and a malevolent market participant. There are incentives, there are circumstances, how they function. And that should be the main area of study. It is interesting that people, but more is another thing, it is very interesting that people at large, public opinion, read English paper, Telugu paper, whatever the paper, it's interesting that people urge severe action by government. They want severe action by government, precisely in those countries where governance are reputed to be weak. And where the governance is poor, Then he said, no, this is a Sanatana punishment. But the origin is, so this is the, this is not Indian observation, it's observation in different countries. So if generation of black money is a consequence of weak governance, if, or at least to the extent generation of black money is a consequence of weak governance, how could empowering precisely the same governance systems to solve this problem on a firm footing? Let me thank Ms. Nirmala Buch for forcing me to prepare for this speech. So I have to refer to old books. And I look forward to the scholarly comments of Professor Deep Mehta. Thank you very much, sir.